Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? Good evening.
You're listening to Straight Talk with Dean and Mark. We thank you for tuning in and hope you enjoy another exciting episode of our show.
Geronimo in the studio. It's the second week of December. We're going through pretty quickly. Before you know it, it'll be 2021. We thank all of you for coming and joining with us this evening. Couple of bit of news. The Electoral College on Monday designated Joe Biden the winner of the November 3rd election, with California casting its 55 votes to put the former vice president over the 270 threshold needed to ensure the victory. Biden is expected to amass 306 votes to President Trump's 232 by the time Hawaii votes right now, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. President-elect is speaking an hour later about the Electoral College vote. Now it's time to turn the page, to unite, to heal, Biden will say, according to excerpts released by his transition office. The final tally from the 50 states and the District of Columbia will be tallied at a joint session of Congress on January 6th. Unlike in 2016, all Republican and Democrat electors cast ballots for their party's candidates as of California's votes. New York's electors included Hillary Clinton, the 2016 Democratic presidential candidate, and her husband, former President Bill Clinton, a former Arkansas governor who opened a post presidency office in Harlem. The Clintons voted together, and shortly thereafter, the former First Lady tweeted, "I believe we should abolish the Electoral College and select our president by the winner of the popular vote, same as every other office. But while it still exists, I was proud to cast my vote in New York for Joe Biden and Kamala Harris." The vote, set by law to occur on the first Monday after the second Wednesday in December, usually occurs with little fanfare every 4 years. But Trump's refusal to concede and challenges of the results by Trump's legal team and Republican allies have put a renewed focus on the democratic process. Local and federal courts have rejected the allegations of election fraud. Now, the United States Supreme Court last Friday rejected a complaint filed by Texas Attorney General Ken Paxton to toss the results in four swing states Biden won: Michigan, Wisconsin, Georgia, and Pennsylvania, that have 62 electoral votes. Despite the losses, Trump said he was disappointed with the high court decision and vowed to keep contesting the election to Inauguration Day on January 20th. No, it's not over. We keep going, and we're going to continue to go forward. We have numerous local cases, Trump told Fox and Friends in an interview that aired on Sunday. Now, laws in 32 states and the District of Columbia require electors to vote for the candidate who won the popular vote in their state. 17 states allow electors to vote for their choice. But the United States Supreme Court ruled in July that faithless electors who don't cast votes for the candidate they were pledged to support can be punished by the state. Now, the Constitution gives each state a number of electoral votes based on its congressional delegation of two senators plus representatives in the House. Now, other than Maine and Nebraska, states give all of their votes to the winner of the popular vote in their state. Boy, that was a lot. This man is not giving up. He can't accept defeat. He's a sore loser. But in his own words, 45, you're fired, man. I mean, just let it go. Be like Frozen, dog, and let it go. Because at some point, you're going to have to realize that we don't want you there anymore. You know, so it is what it is. The people have spoken. I agree with former First Lady Hillary Clinton in that respect. The Electoral College does need to be dismantled and done away with, because at some point you have to realize twice in the last 20 years it has gone haywire. Now, that's a small number, but when you look at it, when the people have spoken and we all go out and exercise our constitutional right to vote, there should not be anyone who stands in the way of that. If we choose option A, they should have no ability to choose option B for us. And as we saw back in 2016, option B was chosen for us. And oh, what a unique option it was. But now, that's coming to an end. We're counting the days down. You figure the day is December 14th. We're about 17 days left in this year, and 20 days until Inauguration Day once we get to January 1st. So a total of 37 days. We got to deal with you for 37 more days. I hope you find where you're going to live or wherever, because it won't be at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, and we can get back to being a true, whatever you want to call it. It'll be better than what it was. So, with that being said, see ya. You know. On another note, Dr. Anthony Fauci says the United States could achieve herd immunity in the second quarter of 2021. By late spring or early summer, now that the COVID-19 vaccine is finally rolling out. The real bottom line is when you get the overwhelming majority of the population vaccinated so that you can get that umbrella of herd immunity, Fauci told MSNBC reporter Holly Jackson on Monday. I believe if we're efficient about it and we convince people to get vaccinated, we can accomplish that by the end of the second quarter of early 2021, namely by the end of the late spring or early summer. The nation's top infectious diseases expert has previously said that around 75 to 80% of the population will need to be vaccinated to reach herd immunity in the nation. Now, the head of the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases on Monday also predicted that Americans with no underlying conditions will start to get the vaccine at the end of March or the beginning of April. It's really going to depend on the efficiency of the rollout, Fauci said. He also said he believes life can start returning to normal in the fall with the help of widespread vaccination. By the time we get into the fall, we can start approaching some degree of relief, where the level of infection will be so slow in society, we can start approaching some form of normality. And Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine began shipping out on Sunday, and a New York City critical care nurse was the first in the nation to receive that shot. There's been a lot of back and forth about that. Some people believe that the vaccination will work. Some people will say it's not. But the only way we can find out is to see what happens with especially the first group of individuals who will be getting that vaccine. So if you're in the Northeast, and I'm switching right now, because if you're in the Northeast, get ready for the snow. That's all I'm going to tell you. Get your heaters, get your thermals, and get everything ready. It's about, I don't even know how cold it is. It's about 36 degrees here in New Jersey. Feels like it's about 29, but we get ready to get the rocking and rolling. So from NJ to NC, it's the six-man Dean Geronimo in the studio with my right-hand man, Mark Lee. So Mark, tell me what's good in your neck of the woods, my brother.
Well, we had some rain earlier today, and it's definitely, we had some cold weather earlier. It's actually been fairly pleasant the last couple of days. I think we might have been in the 60s or the 70s or something like that. So it's been some fairly good weather and all of that. But, you know, we expect that winter is going to show up, and therefore it's not going to last this long. So we do know that things are going to change and all of that. But right now we've been enjoying the break and enjoying some of this warm weather and all of that. And, of course, I just finished doing both of my shows. Had the pleasure of talking to Greg. Grant Malloy Smith, who is a roots musician, and also a second time I'm talking to Ronnie Warner and all of that. And of course, he's the guy that did This Christmas and was breaking down some serious knowledge about the filmmaking industry and Hollywood in general, and taking how it's about connections and all of that. So definitely, that was a great conversation. And then I also had the pleasure of having on the first show, I had on a gentleman that has his own movie house over there in Virginia, Stanton, Virginia, to be exact. So he's talking about how he was surviving as a movie house owner. And then I had the pleasure of having a Marquette basketball player on, a former Marquette basketball player, none other than Travis Diener. So y'all remember that he was the one popping those outside shots and helping the Golden Eagles win in that TBT tournament that was held in the bubble back in the summer. So I had him on, and we shared a little bit about what's going on in the sports world and how he's coping and all of that. So that was a great conversation. I was glad to have my fellow Marquette person on and all of that, even though he did do something, Dean, that I did not appreciate, because, you know, I'm a diehard Minnesota Vikings fan, and of course he went to school in Milwaukee with Marquette, as I did. So he's not even a Packers fan. I might have been upset at him as being a Packers fan. He's worse than that. Y'all know that my brother is a diehard Bears fan, and guess what? Travis Diener also roots for the Bears. So I almost got ready to disown him because he rooted for the wrong team. But I held on, and I did not disown him this time. That doesn't mean I won't disown him later on, but I was not too pleased with the fact that he was a Bears fan and all of that, because, you know, I, not my team. I am definitely a Minnesota Vikings fan. I know you're a little upset because the Ravens are trying to eliminate themselves out of the playoffs, and I'm sitting there going like, wait a minute, y'all were my defense in fantasy, and I did get eliminated, I think it was last week or something like that, so I did get eliminated. I mean, I just put in a roster this time, but not this past Sunday, but the Sunday before, I got eliminated real quickly in the playoffs, and, you know, despite having Tom Brady, the Baltimore Ravens defense, it wasn't any good for me in terms of having that winning streak. So I made the Final Four last year, not even going to make the Final Four this year. I guess I have to get my championship, which I've never won, in 2021. And then I saw in the news that the Electoral College has officially done what we already knew months ago, which is they have elected Biden as president. So hopefully Mr. Trump got the notice and he will get ready to pack his bag and get ready to get out of there, because they went ahead and made it official. He got the right amount, you know, the over 270. So he is the president-elect, even by Electoral College standing. So maybe he can stop all this stupidity in terms of trying to overturn elections and all this other stuff, and just get ready to move on out of here and get ready to get on out. Because, like I said, I don't understand why he won't do that in the first place. And on a sadder note, we did have some other things that were going on and all of that and everything, and that was that the CIAA has announced that they are calling off the basketball season. So for a second year in a row, at least one group of, at least one conference, I'm sure some others will do it as well, but the CIAA is seeing too many cases in their member schools, so they have already called off the season. I know some people are, you know, scaling down on their season, making their season smaller. I don't know if there's any other conferences that have totally eliminated it, but I did see on the news today that the CIAA has said the basketball season is done. We are not having any more basketball season in the CIAA. So I know a lot of folks will not be happy about that. Central used to be in the CIAA, and then they moved to the MEAC. And by the way, they were a pickup game for UNC. And even though they lost, they did play very well, in my opinion, and UNC realized that even though they were a pickup game, that I think they were originally supposed to play Elon, but instead they wound up playing North Carolina Central University, and we're down by 11 to North Carolina Central University. But, you know, UNC does have those big men and all of that, so the big man started wearing and tearing on the guys, and I think they lost by like 8 or 9 points or something like that. But they definitely showed that even our HBCUs are not going to roll over just because the big boys come to play. And while Central may not be having a good record, I think they might be like 1-3 or something like that, it is these kind of games which help them oftentimes get into the tournament. So assuming we have a tournament, I'm thinking that even though they're 1-3, that these kind of games can beef it up when they do play in the MEAC. And assuming that we have a tournament, that might even make them more prepared to get a bid, because we do know that the MEAC gets at least one bid, which is the winner of the conference championship. So we'll see whether that plays out. I know Central has been a couple of times, and it's because of playing and getting beat by folks like UNC and some of the other big colleges. So sometimes playing these guys and losing is a way that you beef up for your regular season. But that being said, I was also glad to see that they did a great job of pumping up, you know, not just rolling over. Because, you know, a lot of times, you know, whether it's the MEAC, the SWAC, or a number of our other HBCUs, you know, the big boys have come playing, whether it's a Wisconsin or Purdue or one of those Kentucky or something like that, and they'll just roll over. Sometimes it don't even look like they're trying to play the game, but it looked like Central was definitely trying to give them a game. Mr. Moten, who I'm a big fan of, definitely looked like he tried to give them a coaching lesson as to how to inspire the team and try to let them know that, yes, UNC was going to come and play them. I don't know. I can't remember whether the game is on Central's campus or on UNC's campus. It might have actually been on UNC's campus. I'm not 100% sure. But wherever the game was played, I was just glad to see that Central was not just going to roll over. Because I feel that too often our teams of any of the small colleges, not just HBCUs, but many of the small colleges, they just roll over. But the last time I checked, and that's one of the things that Travis was talking about, you know, the game is actually a very simple game. It's, you know, you're trying to get the basket into the ball. I mean, yeah, the ball into the basket. I said it backwards. You're trying to get the ball into the basket, and you're trying to, like, stop the other person from doing the same thing. So it's a very simple concept in any of these sports. So, you know, it's not like rocket science. So I was glad to see that they were doing some things to try to show off their skills and all of that. So that's one of the things that is going on and everything. And I see, because I've got my computer on, that we apparently have a guest, and I'm also trying to charge up my phone. So we're going to move over here and see if I can recognize the number, because I was expecting somebody to call from this area, because they are doing a show on Blog Talk Radio as well. So that might be one of those people.
Wow,
it might
okay.
be Mr. Gatewood or somebody like that. But you're going to tell me who it is, and we're going to have a conversation. And actually, you may take the lead in the conversation, because, you know, when you do a lot of podcasts and you do a lot of things in life and everything, then sometimes Mother Nature takes over. So I will at least take over the first part of the interview, but then I might have to run and take care of a break and all of that, because that's just the nature of things and how things go. But tell me who we got on the air, and then I'll at least start the interview, and they can tell a little bit about themselves, and then I might have to go do what I have to go do.
Okay, well, you know what? Hey, man, I got you. So, you know what? Let's see if we can get them in. Welcome to Straight Talk with Dean and Mark. You are now on the line. Tell us who you are and where you're calling from.
Hey, how you doing? This is Minister Curtis Gatewood. It's a pleasure to be on the line.
Hey, Minister Curtis Gatewood. The reason I invited Minister Curtis Gatewood, and we're going to talk about a lot of things, because he's always about a number of things. And as I was saying, I might have to take a quick break and everything, so you may take over a little bit of what's going on and everything. But Minister Curtis Gatewood is joining our family of Blog Talk Radio people. He's got his own podcast. So he's got a podcast that he has launched on the Blog Talk Radio as well. But he is also a masterful person in terms of a lot of the things that we're seeing in terms of society and all of that. He's definitely very much of an activist, was involved in the creation of one of the major marches that goes on in Raleigh every February, and was also very much involved in a number of other issues. I mean, even when we're talking about some of the things that have been going on both here in North Carolina as well as in Georgia with voter suppression, he has been very much at the lead of fighting against these things. So he is definitely somebody that I have a great deal of respect for and all of that. So as I get ready to take care of what I've got to take care of and all of that, I would love to have you and Minister Gatewood talk about the importance of voting and all of that, because we just won a major election and we've got a new administration, which apparently is rolling out some very important people in terms of the way they are handling the creation of their administration. I'm seeing a very diverse administration and all along those lines. So that's kind of my introduction of who Minister Curtis Gatewood is. A very true pioneer and a true leader in our community. So I'm going to let you and definitely Dean have a little bit of a conversation, and then I'm going to jump right back in, because all I got to do is going to take literally all of about 1 minute.
Thank you, Brother Mark Lee, and you certainly, we are certainly appreciative and blessed by the work that you are doing, and you've been doing for a long time as well. As far as the election is concerned, I'd like to say a couple of things. I would say we probably need to watch and pray over these next 40 days of Trump, because, see, I think a lot of attention is going to Biden, which is, you know, to an extent understandable. But we have to remember that Trump is still president, and he has a deadly agenda that could cause some serious damage prior to him leaving. And I just give a few examples of that. If I'm not sure if you all are aware, but in 2019, Trump and William Barr went and reactivated the federal death penalty. And what that means is there has not been a president to enact the federal death penalty since 2003. And why wouldn't those of us who are in the social justice business be really making this a major issue, considering the fact that Trump, during his private life, was the one who went out and purchased ads to try to get the death penalty waged against five innocent black youth in New York, of course,
right.
It became known as the Central Park Five. Well, this is the president who has now reactivated the federal death penalty in 2019, the only president to do so since 2003, and is the only president since the 1800s who, after losing the election, has scheduled death penalty executions on the way out the door. This should be outrageous to the black community, knowing how the death penalty has also been used in a way that is racist and classist. People who are rich and white do not receive the death penalty. And there's been about 96% of the studies that have been done regarding the death penalty show that the death penalty is only used either for the victim. The victim is white, or the defendant is non-white, and so, or both. So it's very much discrimination that's clear in the usage of the death penalty. And for Trump to be using that deadly force on his way out should cause more outrage than I'm hearing from national civil rights activists. So I think that's one thing that we should be watching. We should also be watching how Trump is, of course, using the vaccine, how he is continuously using misinformation regarding COVID-19. He's looked like he could be escalating a war with Iran. And, of course, we know what he's doing to dismantle health care. And last but not least, we know that he is using misinformation to look. It looks as if he's trying to deliberately create a civil war or a race war regarding the misinformation that they are using, when he knows full well he lost the election. He lost by a larger margin than Hillary Clinton. He lost, you know, it's just no question that he lost the election, but he's trying to use the election also as a means of generating violence, hatred, and racism. So these are things that we have to watch. You know, I think more eyes need to be on Trump on his way out, and we deal with Biden once he takes office.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense, and I definitely agree with you on that. One of the things that I've been surprised by is the way that a lot of folks are still using race as like a tool in their own conversation. I was actually shocked when I saw on the news how many folks were members of like the Proud Boys and things of that nature that were marching on Washington trying to overturn an election that was clearly lost by their side. I mean, there's no doubt that the side of right won in this case and everything along that line. But unfortunately, a number of these folks, I think, are very much misdirected and all of that in terms of the reasons that they're even supporting that person that is currently in 1600. And I know I was having a conversation earlier today on one of my streaming podcasts, and the person was actually talking about actually was on the show that I was not on the panel. Otherwise, I would have jumped right into the conversation, but I was making conversation points online with these people. But they were thinking that they had issues because they were coming out of the investment circle out of Australia, and they were having issues with some of the ways that we are talk about race and talk about sexism. And it's my opinion that a lot of these issues are still very prominent in our society, but you know, they were trying to belittle it and feel that it's something that we shouldn't be talking about. And when you hear people that are making those kind of arguments, thinking that race and sexism don't exist or that they are being overblown, what is your response to those folks, or how do you get them to understand that racism still does exist very much in our society, as does sexism, as does a hatred of people of different orientations and things of that nature? Because I'm oftentimes shocked when folks will try to give this argument that, you know, we don't need to concentrate on these issues around the isms that exist in society.
I wish it was just my words that had to convince people. But unfortunately, there are actions on the side of racist actions that you will see and feel institutionally and systemically. For example, you know, you talked about the march that we do during February, and and what caused that march to be initiated was during 2013. Is we had the election of McCrory, and we had the majority of Republicans also in the legislature, and some of the first things they did was, number one, they denied a half million North Carolinians Medicaid expansion, and they noted disproportionately. They did that for two reasons. Disproportionately, those who need Medicaid expansion were Black people. You're seeing it more now through COVID, as it as COVID-19 is taking a more devastating toll on the Black community due to the pre-existing conditions and the health deficiencies that we've had systemically. So the first thing that the North Carolina legislature did, along with Pat McCrory, is they denied a half million people Medicaid expansion that mostly would look like us, and they did so while knowing it would not cost the state of North Carolina one penny. But they did so, another reason, because you had a Black president by the name of Barack Obama, whose name was a part of that legislation known as Obamacare. And then the next thing they did, they surgically, even though the courts later reversed it, and of course it came back as another issue later on, is they surgically put together legislation that would clearly disproportionately deny votes from Black people, or at least abridge their votes, made it harder for them to vote. They've had legislation that would do that. The first legislation came out in the form of 666, House Bill 666, and you know what that means. And then they went back and changed the name of the bill. But the fact of the matter is the devil was already in the bill, and it was there before and after they changed the numbers in the bill. But the fact of the matter is that clearly racism, whether people want to say it or not, but they made clear that they were disproportionately trying to stop Black people in North Carolina from voting. Another thing they did, they eliminated the earned income tax credit, which of course took the earned income tax credit, which allowed a tax break for the poorest North Carolinians, which impacted about 940,000 North Carolinians, took their tax break away from the hardest working North Carolinians to give tax breaks to the richest, whitest, about 25 millionaires in North Carolina. So this is clearly racism at work. I wish I could just say, you know, don't believe racism or believe that there's no racism, but the facts speak louder than words. Action speaks louder than words. And I could go on. About 170,000 people were denied unemployment benefits in North Carolina during that period. And what happened, people don't seem to understand, is by taking the earned income tax credit away and making the poorest people pay more taxes and the rich pay less taxes, Black and brown people are paying more taxes than white folk, and yet we are still being led to believe that we are out receiving free stuff. So if we just know what is going on, we will understand that at no time in our history have Black people received free stuff. At no time in our history have we received handouts. In fact, they need to hand over what they stole.
Yeah, that's very true. They definitely need to do that. And I'm oftentimes also surprised when folks are talking about what they feel minorities are getting during this pandemic era and everything of that nature, when we know for a fact that a lot of folks that are in Congress and in state houses are the ones that are actually getting the big checks, as well as a lot of these big corporations and things of that nature. While I know a lot of folks are struggling just trying to make ends meet or make any ends, much less the meat or anything, and definitely I've seen a lot of folks that are working in gig economy jobs and just trying to make any kind of money in order to pay their grocery bills or pay their rent or pay a number of other things as well. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on that as well, because we do hear folks trying to do what I call the blame game in terms of not giving enough support to our minority communities, as a lot of us are facing hardships with rent and with food and with a number of other things while trying to get, you know, get back into a job after having been laid off in a lot of cases. Or, as I said earlier, going into those gig jobs, which can make a little bit of money, but they don't make as much money as people think they make. And oftentimes you're spending a lot of money on the gas and on the car in terms of maintenance. So even if you say you make a couple of $100, how much of that are you actually making if you have to use it in order for the maintenance of the car? But I'd love to hear your thoughts about how we're doing in terms of supporting our folks in the nation, not just in the our community, African-American community, but in general, because I'm just shamed at a lot of our congresspeople that are sitting there with their big checks and their big houses and can't seem to get any sort of true package put together.
Absolutely. And your concerns are certainly legitimate and based upon the facts. And see, the thing about it is we need to get back to the point where facts matter, truly matter. We just had a dangerous president, a dangerous 4 years, which led people to think that lying is okay, or that you can take truth and change the truth based upon a preferred lie or perception. So with that being the case, the same goes when it comes to the need for these packages to be passed and disseminated, funds, food, everything imaginable that could help to save families. It is more critical than I think we are making of this issue, brother, and I'm glad you mentioned it, because if we continue on the current trajectory, chances are we'll have millions of homeless people within the next few months at the time where it's becoming the coldest, at the time where, you know, the vaccine or the pandemic will probably be escalating at a peak. We're looking at some serious, as Dr. King would say, some difficult days ahead. And it's like the people used to say, in America, if America gets a cold, the black community gets the flu. Now it's gotten even worse when they get a cold, black folk get COVID-19. And so what we're looking at is not only do we have pre-existing conditions when it comes to health issues, we have pre-existing economic conditions because of systematic racism. Through systematic racism, we were already living paycheck to paycheck, paycheck to bad check, paycheck to paycheck advance. We were already struggling. So it would not have taken as much for us to be facing a foreclosure or eviction or repossession because we were already being totally discriminated against. We have people already around the country just been begging for $15 an hour when many people who are in our communities are being paid $7.25 an hour. We've gone 200 years as slaves, and now the best we can do, some of us, is $7.25 an hour. We've only gotten a $7.25 an hour after 200 years. So we just have so many things that are wrong with this country and the economic side of things. So when something like this happens, instead of us lining us up to be the first one to take the vaccine, line us up to be the first one to be paid. Because, unfortunately, I can't say I trust a vaccine, or at least trust being the first ones to take a vaccine in a nation that I know has deliberately killed us on the streets by police officers, a nation that has deliberately violated my rights, a nation that has deliberately used sentencing disparities to make sure we are the occupants of mass incarceration. So when in a nation that we are familiar with the Tuskegee experiment, which was supposed to last 8 months, it ended up lasting 40 years and ended up killing black folks. So don't tell us we'll be the first to take the vaccine. Tell us we'll be the first to get paid. Tell us we'll be the first to be reparated, because for so long we've been last.
No, I definitely agree with you on that and everything. One of the other things that I know that you've been very much concerned about, and actually you have roots in some of rural North Carolina, as does your wife and everything, is environmental justice. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on where we are with environmental justice, because I think that sometimes that even gets ignored. I know a number of the candidates did talk about fracking and a number of other things, but there are other parts of environmental justice that I don't know always get the kind of concerns that they should get. So I'd love to hear your take on where we are in regards to environmental justice. And we know that the environmental justice movement actually started in rural North Carolina. But I'd love to hear your thoughts on where we are.
Yes, first of all, I do want to send a shout out to my beautiful wife, Odessa Burnett Gatewood, who, as you stated, she is a native of Warren County. And for those of you who may not know the history of Warren County, of course, that's where not only the environmental racism movement was birthed out of Warren County. Also, Soul City was coming out of Warren County. So there's a rich history of consciousness in Warren County that we often underestimate. And I think we need to go back to some of our Warren County leaders and ancestors and others who are familiar with these movements and receive some of their wisdom and let them and pick their brains for some of the things that we face today. Because as you mentioned, there are just so many ways that African Americans and other people who are considered to be amongst the oppressed are being mass murdered. And one of the ways it's done is through the environment. We're familiar with the lead at Flint, in Flint. And recently we're familiar with what happened in McDougal Terrace, the largest public housing area in Durham, that was basically the homes are filled with carbon monoxide. So we always must be conscious of our surroundings when it comes to the environment, whether it's the water, whether it's the fumes in the air, whether it's the food, whether in the case of Warren County, where they were worried about a dump being placed there that would be considered to be hazardous to health. We have to always be familiar and considerate of how we are being attacked economically. We've been attacked on so many fronts until sometimes we seem to get distracted. And I think there is enough work for black folk to do to deal with the work of justice as it pertains to black folk. I think what happened over the years is we must have thought that we had already arrived. And I think we started giving a lot of attention to other areas, whether it be the immigrant matter, whether it be LGBTQ, and all these other things, which is okay because they all involve rights and civil rights. But we have to make sure that we have various groups that are focused on certain things. There are already groups that are focused on LGBTQ. There are groups that are focused on immigrant issues, but there are very few groups that remain consistently focused on the issues pertaining to black people. And we must make sure that our civil rights organizations and others, or churches and others, keep a close eye on what is happening to black people. And if you do that, then if you're black, then if you're LGBTQ, it's going to benefit you. If you're black LGBTQ, if you're a black immigrant from Haiti, it's going to benefit you. If you're black trans or whatever you may be, if you're black Muslim, black Christian, black whatever, I've noticed that these police officers, when they shoot, they're not asking you, are you, what's your sexual pronouns? They're not asking you what your religion is. When they see a black person, they use that as a reason to suggest that they were being threatened and that they were facing a violent force, and therefore they use deadly force in response by looking at a black face. So my point is there must be some group. It should be the NAACP, but I can see the things starting to kind of go a little bit south, even during the time that I was working closely with the state of North Carolina. And so one of the things that I want to do with the civil rights organizations and religious organizations is to make sure we not lose focus on the environmental threats, the health threats, the threats that we see when we walk out of the door and see police shooting video after video, or even the systemic guns of black self-hatred created by media misinformation, by miseducation, and the push-outs that we see going on through public out-of-school suspensions, and in other ways how we are being pushed out to fight against each other when we should be rebuilding the village that raised each child.
No, there's no doubt about that. What words of advice would you give for folks, like I said? I know that Dean, my partner in crime on this show and everything, is definitely involved with organizations like the NAACP, but he's also involved with his Greek organization up there in New Jersey and everything. But what words of advice would you give to folks that are in those organizations in order to get them more involved, or you seeing enough involvement from our Greeks and a number of the other organizations, or how would you get them more involved?
Right, right. Well, first, I'm going to assume that most of these people have good intentions, and they want to do the right thing. So, therefore, leadership is critical. Sometimes leadership that goes unchecked, or that is assumed to be righteous, or that is assumed to be accountable, can sometimes be the issue. Because I've noticed with many of the organizations that I work with, the people on the ground, They're ready. A lot of them are fired up, excited, and waiting to do the right thing. But if you have people in some of these positions that would set the wrong tone, then it could create issues and problems, just like we see with the Trump administration. If you got a bad person at the top, it doesn't matter if that bad person is black, white, Republican, Democrat. If you got a person at the top that's willing to do the wrong thing, then it could have a triple down effect. You can have, just like you have triple down economics, you can have triple down stupidity, trickle down ignorance, you can have trickle down do nothingism, you can have trickle down cowardism. So what we have to do is make sure these organizations understand that it's not necessarily a popularity contest. Check your leadership, but also check what you're doing of that person that's in the mirror. That person in the mirror can really do a lot. A lot of times we do rely too much on leaders, but at the same time we put up with too much wrong that leaders are doing. So I would say in every organization, check the leadership. If you're not a part of the leadership, if you have no say in the leadership, find out what the constitutional bylaws are, and find out how you can have more say in the direction and the work that's being done on the ground by these local organizations. Because evidently there is some breakdown in communication when it comes to the people on the ground and those who are in leadership positions. Because I've seen it over and over again. People are ready. People can love you. People can want to do the right thing. And then there is something that happens when you get to the leadership, or things can stop happening, and we need some fired up, ready to go, uncompromising leadership that would take us to the next level.
And that makes a lot of sense. And one of the other things that I've always admired is the fact that a lot of our young people are taking leadership positions and things along that line. And I've definitely been impressed by a number of the millennials and folks that are in that kind of generation, including your daughter and a number of others that fall in that category. So I was wondering if you could speak to the millennials and to the young people in terms of what you're seeing from them, because it looks to me like in a lot of cases they are taking the leadership roles and they're also having a more inclusive kind of attitude about a number of issues, but they have also not forgotten the core values that they were raised with, whether that was your kids being raised by you or a number of the other leaders' kids being raised by their parents. So I was just wondering if you could speak to the millennials that might be listening as well, because whether it's Black Lives Matter or a number of the other things that are going on in our society, I do find that a lot of them are coming from our young leaders.
Absolutely, brother, and I'm so glad you said that because I think they noticed a long time ago, more so than some of the adults, that we were in these positions, or people were in positions, but they were not leading. People are in positions wearing titles, but they are not leading and defending and protecting the generation or the next generation or those generations that must come behind us. And unfortunately, when that happens, it puts the generation behind us at higher risk, because when you see racist police officers, or when you see this racist institution of mass incarceration, when you see this need for reparations and all the other major issues facing the black community, the younger people are at greater risk of being victims and being seen by the racist system as the threat. So naturally, if you're not seen as a threat, if you're seen as a person who's pretty much over and done with as far as your health is concerned, as far as your energy is concerned, and so on and so forth, you're no longer the threat. These younger people are the threat to a racist system. So they're going to be targeted, and they're going to be facing the forefront of the actual acts of racism and oppression. So they are absolutely right in taking it upon themselves to say, wait. These acts are coming directly at us. We just had to deal with these out-of-school suspensions. We just had to deal with these issues where they're taking money out of education and out of HBCUs and other areas where that would normally educate us. We know our friends are being systematically, facing sentencing disparities and all these other things. So I love the fact that they are not waiting. In fact, they know history as well. Our young people know history. They know that Dr. King, Malcolm X, and all these other leaders, Fred Hampton, which I do want to mention the fact that Fred Hampton, the beloved Black Panther Party leader in Chicago, unfortunately, his sad anniversary killing took place on December 4th, which was not that long ago. And people need to understand that Fred Hampton, along with a roommate he had, I'm trying to think of his name, I think it was Mark Clay, something like that. But in any event, everyone knows Fred Hampton, but there were actually two people in the apartment where the police officers came in, did a no-knock search, and shot up the place the same way that they did. Now that this generation community can relate to, because it recently happened to Breonna Taylor. So the fact of the matter is these issues are actually intergenerational. And so we need people fighting on every front. We need and love the leadership of the younger energy that's coming into this movement, these movements, whether Black Lives Matter or whatever the movement may be, because I know there are a lot of grassroots organizations that not even receive the type of national attention that Black Lives Matter has received, but there are several grassroots organizations out here in these communities that are leading. They're not waiting on anybody to tell them what to do. They're not having to wait on the chain of command or someone to tell them it's okay if they march, it's okay if they are permitted, if it's okay if they take action. They actually go out, have their meetings, or get online, or get on Instagram, or get on Twitter, Black Twitter, and they send the message out, we're going to be holding a rally, or we're going to be taking an action in such and such a place. And the black folks who are paying attention are responding. And that's the way it should be. It should not take a whole week or month of approval after the issue has come and gone that we decide, oh, now we have approval to march. So this is exactly what we need to see. And I would love for any of these groups to contact me at 919-939-6311. And if you ever want to send me an email, you can send it to, it's easy to remember, because my name is Minister Curtis Gatewood. So if you just send me an email to Gatewood Loves, L-O-V-E-S, Justice, J-U-S-C-I-C-E, @gmail.com, Gatewood Loves Justice @gmail.com, or give me a call, and we can continue figuring out ways that we can work intergenerationally together.
That makes a lot of sense. Now, one of the things that I thought was a great case of misinformation, and we're talking about that person currently at 1600, and I'd love to hear your thoughts on this as well, is when he tried to claim that he did this great job of supporting HBCUs. I know that that's some of the things that he's put out there in terms of, like, when he was campaigning and all of that, but I don't know that he necessarily did all of that great work for the HBCUs. So when you heard this kind of thought that he was trying to claimed that he had put all this money out for the HBCUs in terms of being supportive of them. What was your reaction when you heard that, and what kind of ways can you dispel this myth that he tried to do something to help the HBCUs, talking about that current person at 1600?
Well, let me first say this, brother, and I want to say this to everyone who's listening, because I noticed near the end of the campaign, we started seeing black entertainers such as 50 Cent, such as Ice Cube, such as there's a few others that come to my mind, but I can't think of certain names right now. But they came very high profile in their support. You know, we already knew about Kanye West, became very supportive of Trump. And usually when you see this happen, it's usually either done through miseducation or centered around one issue. And what we cannot do, we cannot afford to do, is I just gave you the wide array of issues, whether it's economic, whether it's environmental, whether it's educational, whether it's through the judicial system. There's just too many issues facing black people for people to take one issue and decide they're going to use that one issue to support a candidate. Let's just say if we even give Trump, assume that Trump did something to support HBCU, because I'm not going to get into that fight, I'm not going to have anybody sending me something Trump sent, did for HBCU. I'm just going to say, let's assume he did something for HBCU. But even a broken clock can be right, well, some would say twice a day, but now I say once a day, since we now have clocks that can tell us whether it's a.m. or p.m. So I'm going to say a broken clock can be right once or twice a day. But the fact of the matter is, what you don't want or begin to tolerate is a clock that has 24 hours and you're willing to accept wrongness for 23 hours or 59 minutes. My point is, we must hold Trump and whomever accountable to every issue that impacts black people. Don't tell me that you're supporting Trump for HBCU while he's out trying to build the KKK. Don't tell me that you're trying to support Trump for HBCU when he's telling the police officers to be hard on him and start using more force and bringing in the military and bringing in the National Guard to shoot and kill black people on the streets. Don't tell me that you love Trump because he's a businessman, when in fact he's not. If you know his history, he's one of the worst businessmen ever to walk on the face of the earth. How many of us gonna have $500 million that we lose before the end of our lifetime? This man has lost more money than could ever be imagined by any person or any human on earth. But I'm just saying, if you want to suggest that he's a great businessman, you can't tell me that Trump, you're going to support a Trump or a leader that's supposedly a good businessman when he's taking money that should be going to poor working people and especially those who are black and oppressed, and giving that money to the richest 1%. This man doing, I think it was 2017, he created a situation where for the first time, the richest 400 Americans were paying less taxes than the rest of the nation. And so for people to act as if you're supposed to look the other way while all these things that are impacting children and youth and elderly and poor and black and people who have been wrongfully incarcerated for your one issue, I want to say to hell with that.
That makes a lot of sense and everything. And you mentioned earlier about the way that the police sometimes impact and attack our youth and things along that nature. We just had an incident not that long ago in Ohio. I'd love to hear your reflections on that and what you're hearing about what happened in that case. Because last time I heard, I think the gentleman was coming back from a dental appointment when he was shot and killed. And some people are saying that he was actually holding a hero sandwich or a Subway sandwich in his hand and not a gun. But somehow they mistaken a gun for a Subway sandwich. And I've eaten my share of Subway sandwiches. I've never seen one that was shaped or looked like a gun yet. So maybe I'm missing something, or maybe I'm getting the wrong kind of sandwich. But I was wondering your thoughts on what happened in Ohio and just those kind of incidents in general. Because it seems like they continue to happen. Even here in Durham and other places, they still continue to happen on a regular basis.
Absolutely. And let me just say this. People should really understand this. What to me was so sad about this, and again, I often look at not only what happened, but when it happened. And I'm not sure if the police officers were deliberate in doing this, but this also happened on the anniversary of the killing of Fred Hampton. On December 4th, this gentleman, he was killed by what has been described as mistaken identity. And the thing about it is, it's like you said, black folk are the only people that I've ever seen killed because somebody thought a sandwich was a gun, or the only people that ever been killed because somebody thought a wallet was a gun, or a telephone was a gun. And yet, if you noticed in that rally, one of those Black Lives Matter rallies that took place in the aftermath of George Floyd's death, his murder, his lynching right there on the street where the whole world could see it. There was a white gentleman who walked right down the street with one of the longest guns you're ever going to see after he had shot and killed two black protesters, walked in front in the face of almost an army of police officers. Not one police officer shot this white guy. But now, and it was very clear what he was holding was a gun. And then the next thing is white folks they have constitutional selective amnesia. Oftentimes white people are so extreme in advocating for the Second Amendment, which provides the right for people to carry arms. But when black folk carry arms, then it's supposed to be justification for being murdered. So first of all, the gentleman was not carrying a gun. Secondly, if he was carrying a gun, first it's the police jobs to determine whether he was threatening the police with the gun. So just to keep saying black folk, we shot him because we thought he had a gun or he had a gun, that still is not a reason to kill a person in the United States of America, where the Constitution provides the right to carry an arm. So we've just been so much stupidity and racism until some of us are starting to believe it and buy it. I think we should rise up in this moment. First of all, as a part of the organization that I'm now belong to, Justice Administration, and through Justice Administration, we gave the birth to the Stop Killing Us Solution Campaign, also known as SCOOP. And one of the things we did in 2017 when this campaign was put together is we put together 18 points that police across the country, or law enforcement, because when I say police, I'm saying law enforcement, which includes sheriff, deputies, drug agencies, everybody, the state patrol, the sheriff, whomever, ICE. But we put together 18 points, Brother Lee, and if those points were considered universal and was passed across the nation, we would have none of this foolishness. And they simply address the basic. They basically, what they do is we use the U.S. Constitution to basically support the demands that we are requiring. And if these people were supporting the U.S. Constitution that they claim to believe that they support, then a lot of this would not be happening. First of all, the first thing we have on our list is bringing in to no-knock searches. This was in 2017 when we put this list together. We call for the total abolishment or the universal abolishment of no-knock searches. Right now we've seen no-knock searches has led to so many shootings where police officers think they have a case where they can just break up into somebody's house without knocking and go in shooting. When in fact, there's so many things that could go wrong with that. This is a war tactic, number one. This is not to be done for domestic. Number two, it violates the Constitution when it comes to making sure that you have a warrant and that persons are given an opportunity to respond in a way that is civil. Because every person is, if you start knocking around their door or doing something around their door, if they have a gun, they're going to go get it. And by the time you break into that door, they're not going to know who it is. And a lot of times, unfortunately, these no-knock searches, the police officers are not even wearing uniform. And so they're going to, they might fight, shoot back, not even knowing they're shooting at the police. And then the police are going to come back shooting with 100 rounds. And so one thing we ask is to eliminate no-knock searches, we ask that there be a screening process that would eliminate racist police officers. In other words, do a background check on all police officers, making sure that there's no, you can just, now you can almost do it, a search online to make sure that they're not affiliated with any KKK, any Proud Boys, any racist white supremacist organization, making sure that there are certain mental evaluation to take place. Of course, we all need mental help. It's not to say that anybody with mental challenges can't be police officers, but they need to find out how that those things might impact a person's willingness or ability to be fair, since they're going to be kind of done. So there's just so many things that we are calling on that are very specific, and if they were implemented, it would make the difference between day and night. And people know how to do this. We're not the only ones who can figure this out, but there are a lot of people who want to see exactly what we see happening.
No, that's definitely very much the case and everything. For those that are not as familiar with you as I am and everything, if you would share a little bit about your own history of activism and how you got involved in activism, I'm sure a number of the folks that are listening to Straight Talk with Dean and Mark and even Dean himself might like to know a little bit about your early background. I've definitely heard a lot of your views, and I know the listeners have as well, but not everybody knows who Curtis Gatewood is, so I'd love you to do a little bit of backstory to tell folks a little bit about how you got involved in the whole activism thing, whether you were doing it in high school and college or whether it came to you later in life, and just some of the things that you've been involved in for those that are not as familiar with you as I am.
Hey, man. Well, man, first of all, I appreciate what you're doing, Brother Mark Lee, because this actually gives me an opportunity. Hopefully, I'm not here to talk so much about myself, but I'm hoping I can inspire someone who may feel like because they were not born in a certain family or because they were not born in a certain zip code or because they were not born with a certain color of skin, that they have the world against them and they can't do anything but just wait to die with no hope. I want people to know that, you know, that I came through the rough parts of, you know, this country. My father gave birth to 14 children. 10 boys and 4 girls, and I'm the 12th child. I'm one of the youngest in my family. There's only 2 younger than I am. And my father was born in 1916. Of course, right after 1915 is when you had the birth of a nation and you had racism was at its peak. You know, that's right when we started getting a resurgence of the Ku Klux Klan and all these other things that take place right as my father's being born. My father didn't talk a whole lot about racism, but he did make sure nobody bothered his family. He was very protective of his family. And so my brothers, Joseph Gatewood, who is about 7 years older than I am, and the one closest to him, who's about 6 years older, who's now deceased, his name was Aaron, but they were both members. They were both leaders, like youth leaders in my community. Joseph was the president of the youth council, Anson County Youth Council, NAACP. My brother Aaron was the vice president of the youth council. I was 10 years old at the time, and that was when I joined the NAACP. And I used to watch them. I used to stand over their shoulders as they planned marches against racism, marches against things that were happening in their school where a white person and a black person get in a fight. The black person gets suspended, but the white person doesn't. They were there dealing with real issues at the, you know, ages of 16, 17, and see, I'm 10 years old watching and being inspired. Had they been drug dealers, I might be a drug dealer. Had they been into a gang, I might be a gang member. I don't know. But through the grace of God, those brothers who impacted me at a time where I was very impressionable, they were civil rights activists. So that kind of led me into becoming a member of the NAACP at 10 years old. I was out, you know, as a fundraiser in my community, walking around as a child selling donuts for the NAACP. and hearing all these issues right there in my household about what was going on and making me really want to get into that fight. I would be going to NAACP meetings very young. I was, you know, sometimes I'd rather be playing basketball, but while I'm sitting there listening, I'm listening to all the issues and injustices that are taking place in our communities. And so from that point on, any time I checked out a book from the library as a child, if I had to do a report as a child in school, I did a report on Martin Luther King, I did a report on Malcolm X, I did a report on the Black Panther Party, I did a report on Harriet Tubman or Ida B. Wells. I think my consciousness was, you know, really coming alive. And so now, you know, so when I went into the workforce, my first job, I'm 15 years old, and I'm a bag boy, what they refer to as a bag boy for Winn-Dixie. And I noticed that the black youth, such as myself, we were never allowed to touch the cash register. But we bagged groceries, we did stock, we clean out the incinerator, we did all the other stuff, we get up on the truck when it's hot and send down the food send the food down that we taken off the truck, all those types of things. Those were the things we did. And so I just happened to ask the manager one day, I said, am I going to ever run the cash register and do these other things? And he couldn't believe I asked him. I'm 15 years old. And what he did was so interesting. He said, you want to run the cash register? I said, why not? And so he started me the next week running the cash register. I was like one of the first blacks, other than I think they might have had a manager or something before me. But, you know, those were the types of things I started becoming conscious of whenever I go into an environment. I would kind of like look around and see who's leading and see what they're saying and those types of things. So that was like one of my first activist steps, was to actually, in fact, make something happen. And after I ran the cash register, then people started realizing, hey, you know, why can't I run the cash register? But the cash registers then are not like they are now. The cash registers then, they actually require you to be able to think on your feet and be able to do math on your feet, your back, the right change and everything. Didn't tell you how much change to your back and all those types of things. And so they felt like black folk, that was too much for black folk to do. And plus, they didn't want black folk messing with the money. And mm-hmm. so those things, we had to break a few barriers there right away. But after I left, you know, Wade Burr went into college and everything, that was an NAACP chapter that I eventually became a part of, but I didn't really go to that many meetings. I went into the workforce, got out there, and really I was working so hard until I did not have the time to actually get into the community because I was working retail. I was a retail manager for years, almost a decade. And then I got to the point where I just said, I have to come out of this retail because my spirit is not being fulfilled. My purpose is not being fulfilled. So I ended up resigning from retail in 1987, moving back to Durham in 1988, joined Mechanics and Farmers Bank. And at Mechanics and Farmers Bank is when I was given the opportunity to meet the community. Hold 1 minute, please.
Yes. Come back and tell us more about this story and everything. So, Dean, you still there with me?
Sorry, sir. Can you hear me?
Cool. Yeah, we hear you.
Oh. Yeah, we can hear you. Yeah. So that's actually when I moved to Durham because as a part of my retail management position, I've been transferred in various places. I've been transferred from Charlotte, D.C., Oxford, various places around the state and, in fact, in various states because one of the things I was doing as a retailer, I was kind of like a troubleshooter. They would send me in to kind of clean up some of the stores after they had been going down, driven down by some poor management or whatever. And I would come in and be there for a few months, and then I'm going off to the next place. But I was I think I was living in Manassas, Virginia when I moved. I decided enough is enough. I got to get back to, you know, what God has for me to do. And in 1988 is when I did move to Durham, married my beautiful wife, Odessa Burnett. And we married right there in Durham. I'm working for McCann's and Farmer Bank. I started my own organization called Establishment for Economic Equality. As a part of that organization, I was recruited by the NAACP to serve as the Economic Committee Chair. After serving as Economic Committee Chair for 2 years, I decided I was going to run for president of the Durham NAACP. People thought I was crazy. They said, you're too young. You can't do this. You're not supposed to do this. You're supposed to wait in line for 50 years. I said, but what does the Constitution say? And so by reading the Constitution of the NAACP, at that time it only required that you be a member 30 days prior to the election. And so I ran for president. Now, of course, now it's a little bit longer time. They require 6 months that you're a member 6 months prior to running for office. But I ran for president of the NAACP. Of course, when I ran for NAACP president, everybody knows we came in swinging. We were fired up. We were ready to go. We started addressing issues right away. We started making changes right away. We started trying to bring more visibility to the organization. We started dealing with issues regarding violence, regarding homelessness, regarding education. I was arrested several times due to protesting the out of school suspensions, or the firing, or the terminating black principals when it was unjustified. So, of course, when they hire Ann Denlinger, that we considered to be a racist hiring from the school board that was majority white at the time. They hired Ann Denlinger over a black male out of Chicago who was much more qualified, who had what we believe to be the skills to address some of the issues in Durham. And had that happened, we believe it would have very much minimized the violence that we're seeing today. I feel like much of the violence that you see today in Durham, North Carolina, and other communities is because we had racist leadership in the schools. Either it was racist, or if it was black folks, it was black folk who were unconscious. And the leadership that had taken place in our public schools have led to a lot of the violence that we are seeing, because when you're not protecting the children, when you're not protecting those children and you're allowing the system to discriminate against them at their early ages and discourage them and dispirit them and send them out into the community or out of school suspension, then you are setting them up to become gang bangers. You're setting them up to be recruited by gang members. You're setting them up to have to give up on who they are and whose they are. And so that was one of the main fights that I would do as a part of the NAACP in Durham. We attended every school board meeting, and wherever we felt we needed to protest, we would protest. If it led to arrest, if it led to people calling me bad names, if it led to the newspapers coming against me, it did not matter. We would be there every school board meeting, because we knew if we went without fighting for those young people, they were going to end up in the streets with guns and drugs.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Now, one of the things that I know that oftentimes goes on, unfortunately, with our leaders and everything, and we can even go back to, like, the Black Panthers, we can go back to Malcolm X, Martin Luther King, and a number of others, is that too often when there are leaders in the community, they are targeted in one way or another, whether that's targeted by the police, whether that's targeted by people to kind of like belittle their character or things of that nature. And I know that you've definitely faced that in your career and everything. So what kind of advice would you give the folks that are going into leadership, knowing that they're going to have to face that? Because that's something that you've had to deal with on a number of different ways. We won't go into details, but I know you've had to face a lot of times that folks would go after you or target you in a lot of different ways. But I was just wondering, the folks that want to be leaders in our community, what advice do you give to them in order for them to realize that this is something that they're going to have to face, and that what kind of ways do you tell them to deal with these kind of attacks on character? We've even seen that on some national elections. I'm thinking about the ways that they went after Cal Cunningham and a number of other people.
Right, right. Well, first of all, now I can't speak for everybody as it pertains to their religious beliefs, but what I would recommend is, even if you do not believe in God, if you do not believe the scriptures, you should read the scriptures. Now, I happen to believe much of the scriptures, and I think I believe the most important aspects of the scriptures by believing that there is a higher force than myself that will handle certain situations beyond my control. So that's one of the things that I think brought black folks as far as we've become. I really believe in that song, "We've Come This Far by Faith," because when you're being attacked by a system systematically, as we have been, then it's really beyond a person's individual ability to fight these things. And so the best thing you can do is have some type of higher source that you believe where you can find strength, that, you know, faith is described as the evidence of things hoped, evidence of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. There are things that you cannot see that you, but you know that there is something there larger than you. And had it not been for that, I don't think I could have survived. And I think most of the time that I read about great leaders in our past, there was a certain level of faith. It may not have been Christianity. It could have been being a Muslim, as in the case of Malcolm X. It could have been something else. But I think, first of all, those of us who are going into this area of work, it is so dangerous, it is so oppressive, it is so ugly, that you have to believe in something larger than yourself. If not, I think it will destroy you, because, you know, many people will die just from stress. You know, and stress is one of the number one killers, especially in the black community. So we have to understand it can be very stressful because there's so much politics involved. And whenever there's politics involved, a lot of times things that will happen to you does not make sense. There's also a lot of conspiracies that will take place when you get involved in this type of work. In other words, it makes it harder for people to believe you when you say you are being picked on or targeted when there is a conspiracy involved. Because in a conspiracy, there are people on various levels with various sources, empowered in various ways who may not like you. And so what they can do, they can conspire or orchestrate certain things in a way where it can be presented where it actually looks like you are, in fact, a villain, when in fact you are a victim. In fact, it was Malcolm X who said that the media is so powerful that it can make the victim look like the villain and the villain look like the victim. And so you can have so many entities working against you simultaneously until it can bring the appearance that you're a bad person when they are ganging up on you for that purpose. So, and especially when the media gets involved. And so that is why, and I'm just going to say some of this stuff, on September 18 and September 25th of the year 2019, there were two press conferences held against me attacking my character that was actually held against me by people who I consider to be civil rights colleagues who held press conferences. Now, listen, they didn't come to me. They didn't talk to me. They called press conferences to the news. Now, regardless of what you might think about me personally, let me say this to all black folk. If you did not see another black person do something that is considered to be wrong or criminal, or that could impact their character or livelihood, if you did not see it with your own eyes, do not stand into the media or anywhere else and say they did it. That's the basics of civil rights. That's the basics of human rights. The basics of civil rights is due process, equal protection under the law, and it should apply in every situation, whether it's Me Too, You Too, or whomever. If you have an absence of due process, you have a flawed problem, and you could have a flawed method in how you are perceiving people to be, especially if you're looking at them from an eye of where you are judging these people. So my thing to the Me Too movement is the Me Too movement had a flaw in how it eliminated due process. You can't go from one extreme to the other. You can't say, well, men
are violating women. So now what we're going to do is make sure we believe all women. Those are two extremes. No, what you do is make sure women are protected. You don't go against women and make them feel as if they cannot report abuse, as if they can't report harassment. They should be heard. But at the same time, you must have due process, because guess what? Not only must we protect our women, but we also do not want to go back to the same stories of Emmett Till, where you can have a woman to say anything and you believe it, because we just had that. We've been there, got the T-shirt, we've done that, got the T-shirt and the hat. We had murder after murder, lynching after lynching. And guess what? Between 1890 and between 1950, there were probably about 5,000 or 6,000 lynchings that we knew of. And guess what? One of the main weapons they used, they would go before the media to put out a story against a black person without due process. They would deliberately go around the courts because they could control the media, and they could control the court of public opinion, because they had already created a biased opinion against black people, and especially against black men. So if you've already created a bias within the general public, if you're going to use the court of public opinion, black people are already at a disadvantage. You're even at a disadvantage even when you use the judicial system. But at a minimum, what you want is fair and impartial due process for everything that happens, as it pertains especially to black people. That was one of the reasons, and this is why this troubled me so bad, if not just necessarily personally about myself, but the NAACP came into existence because of the fact that there was no due process for black people. And all white races had to do was anytime they saw an intelligent black person, black woman, black man, anytime they saw that person to be a threat, whether it was an economic threat, whether it was a political threat, whatever type of threat it could have been, they would identify that leader or that person and make up a story. And usually it was in terms of something sexual, or it was in terms of something that was highly emotional, that would get people angry. And they would take that story to the media. The media would have to take the story and carry it widely across the media areas, whether it be across the state, across the community. And then they would create a prejudice based upon a false narrative. And it would get folks angry, so angry until they would justify the lynching even though they're on false pretenses. So if anybody is going to demand due process, if anybody is going to say, don't go out in the public and say that a black person did something that you did not see, it certainly should be NAACP and civil rights advocates. So that's one of the things that I would recommend. Number one, do not deviate ever from justice principles. Do not deviate, and require that those you work with do not deviate from basic justice principles. Due process, making sure both sides of the story is being told, making sure that fair and impartial, objective people who are not a part of a political game. Because guess what? The thing that you addressed about that dealt with me, dealt with it about 10 days before an election. And a lot of times with the politics and power involved, it is easy for a conspiracy to be developed. But the way you fight a conspiracy is not just listen to me and say, well, Curtis Gatewood is out trying to say this or trying to say that. Stick to the basic principles of the Constitution of the United States of America. And those principles say that any time there is some type of dispute or allegation, then there must be due process. And people are to be considered innocent until proven guilty. And unfortunately, in America, even death could even be a setup. But the point is, at least allow people to have due process. And so that's what I would recommend. And I would also recommend that you keep fighting, no matter who, no matter what, no matter how ugly it gets. If God sees you into this fight, then you have to be prepared to fight, to let justice run down like water, righteousness like a mighty stream, stand there like a tree that is planted by the water. Do not give up, endure, and then in somehow, in some way, my faith would say, seek ye first his righteousness, the kingdom of God, and all things shall be added unto you some way, somehow.
I definitely couldn't have said it more better myself and everything. Now, one of the things I hadn't mentioned to you is you definitely talked a little bit about law enforcement and about some of the things that go on in law enforcement. Dean actually works in the corrections department over there in New Jersey and everything. What advice would you give to folks that are trying to do right? And I definitely know that Dean is one of those just people that are doing work in law enforcement and corrections, but that are working in these kind of industries, whether that's law enforcement, whether that's the sheriff's office, whether that's corrections. But what kind of
right.
words of encouragement would you give to folks that are actually working within the system?
Amen, amen. And I'm glad you asked that because, you know, what I thought was interesting, and I made it clear when I saw it happening, is, you know, there are black law enforcement officers who actually protested against their own union, the Fraternal Order of Police. They protested when they realized the union endorsed President Trump. And they were not protesting because it was a political thing that they endorsed President Trump, but those black officers were protesting the fact that they knew Donald Trump did not give a damn about justice for black people. And they felt like if you were going to make an endorsement, at least consider the black law enforcement officers who make up this fraternal order or this fraternity or this union. And so they actually went out protesting. They were holding up signs and doing different things right at the Fraternal Order of Police office because they felt that the Fraternal Order of Police had misused its power or abused its power and did not consider not only the black law enforcement officers, but the black community. So there are things that the law enforcement officials might know of, about that's going on internally. And what I would say to those officers is to stop, look, and listen to what is going on. And they, too, can call me because I have several recommendations that I think would be in the best interest of any person who's pursuing justice, whether they're black, whether they're white, polka dot, whatever. Because if you want justice, then some of the things that I'm telling you about how we must avoid hiring people who are part of, you know, a white supremacist group that should have been destroyed 150 years ago, that has never been destroyed. Because if you allow these racist groups to exist, then of course, those members are going to become part of a workforce, whether they work with the police, whether they work in health, whether they work, you know, wherever, in a bank. These racists are going to be in the workforce if we allow racist organizations such as the Ku Klux Klan terrorist groups to exist. So one of the things I would recommend is that we do have conversations with some of these officers about some of the key issues because I'm sure they are witnessing racism. They have children, they have wives, they have parents that I'm sure they would not want to be a part of an unjust arrest, unjust brutality, and a wrongful killing. So I think there's room for us to talk. And again, my number is 919-939-6311. I initiated a group called Justice Ministration. Justice Ministration is the acronym for Jesus Uniting Souls to Increase Community Engagement Ministration. And then, of course, we gave birth to the Stop Killing Our Solution campaign, which deals with all forms of wrongful killings, whether they be through police, whether they be through the community at large, whether they be through legislators who I consider to be legislative terrorists, if they are going to take legislation and use it to kill black folk by taking their health care or using it by putting black folk on death row when they know the death row is racist, if they're going to be using it to, cut funds in education that are needed for black people, whether from preschool through 12 and then college. Because I do want to say this before I move on, as we talk about racism, there is a racism that we need to take, or well, I would say an issue that we need to keep in consideration as we try to make things better for our people and generations to come. Frederick Douglass said, "It is easier to build strong children than to repair broken men." We need to give a lot of attention to preschool. Now, but we have to be careful, because that's one of the areas where black folk actually oftentimes own a business in early childhood education. So we don't want it to be systematically taken over, but we do want it to be fully funded by those struggling child care workers or owners, especially in black communities. And what they're doing is they are struggling, and then what will happen, a larger institution or a corporation will create a preschool, or a system will create a preschool and either leave them without funding, or they would be at a big disadvantage in providing the quality child care that is necessary. Because what is needed is quality child care in the black community. But also, we do not need the elimination of black child care providers. And so there's a little thing going on that we need to address as it pertains to the elimination or the threat of black ownership when it comes to early childhood education, and the simultaneous need to make sure that it is quality for children that are being born in society, and that parents are being provided the support through social services and other areas to ensure that they can have their children in the best early childhood environment as possible, because what happens between birth to age 3 can determine whether a person will see prosperity or poverty.
Yeah, I can definitely agree with that and everything. Now, one of the things we're fortunate to have listeners not just from here in North Carolina and in New Jersey, but throughout the country, but also throughout the world. So what kind of, like, things would you like to share with the global community that they may not know about the justice movement, and what are some of the things that you think that our global audience might be interested in knowing about what's going on in the justice movement? Because I sometimes feel that a lot of times we don't know what's going on in their justice movements. I know that I've got a friend of mine who's in Nigeria, and they're actually facing some Black Lives Matter movements with their police officers. But the difference there is that a lot of times the police officers that we're talking about are white police officers against black citizens, where there's a majority African country, so it's very much a black-on-black crime there, because the officers are both black as well as the folks that are being victimized, but they feel that they have some things that are similar to what's going on in our society, even though they might put it more in the classism kind of aspect versus the race aspect. But I was just wondering, what are some of the messages that you would like to share with our global community that is listening, because we do have folks listening from around the globe?
Absolutely. That's good. And first, I'm glad, Brother Mark, that you brought out the fact that all of the oppression does not come from whites. We have to watch racism. We have to watch this fantasy of white supremacy. But at the same time, we cannot give black people a pass, or any other person passes, when they commit injustices to other people. So the anti-oppression movement should be transitional, should be transparent, and it should also be one that transcends race, nationality, so on and so forth. And so we certainly want to make sure, and that's unfortunately, that those things end up, I think, has served as a problem in the black community in a way where it could have prevented us getting to the next phase or freedom or the promised land, is because sometimes we think we're supposed to tolerate mistreatment when it's happening in our church or when it's happening within our organization, that where there's a black face up front or a black face is put into the police department or police chief or a black person is put in charge of the school system and they put a black face sometimes out there. And COINTELPRO should have caused us to learn a lot, because what J. Edgar Hoover showed us is that he can take a black person and get to black folk and destroy black folk in a way that white people cannot. They would use an infiltrator. They would pay sometimes, and sometimes they didn't have to pay much because of the level of black hatred that had been created, black self-hatred that had been created systemically, until it wouldn't take much of a payment to get a black person to come in and do damage that would have not been able to have succeeded had a white person tried it, because we are conscious on one hand of the racism that happens, but a lot of times we're not conscious of the black self-hatred and the infiltration that would take place when it comes to black folks treating us badly. So our fight against oppression has to be universal through our nation and world, because we must protect those who are most vulnerable. And so I would say Justice Administration is calling for the rebuilding of the village. And what we call the village is the African proverb speaks clearly and well to the notion that it takes a whole village to raise one child. I believe that we can connect with Africans, people are part of the UN, the international community, and in other areas to help to rebuild our communities, whether it's America or whether it's somewhere in South Africa or Africa. We can protect children. I think that should be our goal, is to protect little ones, the elderly, and others who are not capable of protecting themselves. So to rebuild the community movement, I think, is coming. And to rebuild the community means it's kind of like taking self-help to another level, not just through building black businesses, but building relationships with all the major stakeholders within the community, whether it's the mother, whether it's the business owner, whether it's the school educator, whether it's the person who is illiterate, the wino, or whomever, and become more conscious of each life within our community and bring the realization of a scripture which says, love thy neighbor as thyself. If you hate yourself, you're going to likely hate your neighbor, or do your family, the people who love you the most, do them the most injustice. So there is going to be more like an attitude, more so than necessarily a policy or program, whereby we become more conscious in how we love our community and those who love us most, and we build there. As Booker T. Washington philosophy, which said, cast down your buckets where they are, because a lot of times we're going with our buckets over to cross the track, when in fact we've left the track tore up from the floor. In fact, we could do more building in the track. And another point in case I'll make about this is, like, for example, we have civil rights organizations going to Joe Biden, telling Joe Biden, we need this, we need that, we need this, we need that, we need this. That's fine, but are you going to be using the power that you have to make sure you have justice? Black folk who are in leadership, are you going to be using your power to make sure the people in your organization are treated right? Are you going to make sure the people in your organization, whether it's a fraternity, whether it's organizations, NAACP, or whatever, are you going to make sure they are consistently following the policies and the Constitution and bylaws that you've established, and that you're not using a double standard, or you're not allowing certain people to eliminate the internal precedent of being right, the internal protocol or the internal principles? If you are throwing them out the door and allowing them to mistreat people within the organization,
then you are no better. You're no better than the person you're going to meet over across the track. That person can in turn give you a few dollars and have you come back and destroy the whole community. So we need to make sure that we understand when I say justice, I mean justice externally and internally. Right now we're just dealing with external justice. We are asking the racists to give us justice, which is okay because the racist has power. The racist has a lot of systemic problems that they are creating on innocent and vulnerable people. At the same time, if we are not consistent in demanding internal justice with the power that God has given us, then we are troubled.
Yeah, definitely can agree with you on that and everything. Now, how do you feel we're doing? Because I know I've talked on a number of my podcasts and a number of shows that I've been involved with. I know it's something that Dean's very much concerned as well. But how do you think we're doing in terms of education? Because I feel that we should definitely do more with education, both in terms of teaching that history, and you've given a lot of historical lessons today, whether it's about Fred Hampton, whether it's been about Malcolm X or a number of other folks that you've alluded to, but also even about our ways that we teach finances, the ways that we teach a number of other things that I feel we are not teaching enough in our school system, and we've gotten away from teaching vocation and a number of other things. So I'd love to hear some of your thoughts about how you feel we're doing in terms of education and what we can do better.
Brother, I'm glad you asked me that, man. And I tell you, I wish we could be talking to the world right now. I'm telling you, I wish we could be talking to the world because the world needs to listen right now, Brother Lee. Because, see, what we have done is we failed to value knowledge. We are trying to put all of the eggs in the basket of formal education. And it was through self-knowledge and information that we might have received from our parents, our grandparents are reading a book that we were not instructed to read by our instructor, but having the initiative to read about Frederick Douglass, to read about some of these other heroes that we're not even aware of. We're not even a tip of the iceberg when it comes to knowledge about who we are and whose we are. And so, but we are empowered whenever we get this information. It's a fact. It can be traced. People who know about themselves, even in preschool, we found that those who know more about the oppressed, who know more about themselves, do well. They have the confidence to perform. They have the confidence when they know who they are and when they love themselves and their history. So if we are not pressing this, because one of the things I would do as a part of Justice Administration, I would do anyway, is anytime I would speak somewhere, or anytime we had a meeting, whatever is going on in history during that particular time, whether that meeting is in December, like I just talked about the history as it pertains to December 4 and the anniversary killing, unfortunately, of Fred Hampton, whatever month that we're in, I wouldn't wait till February, but wherever month we're in, I might recommend that to other people and speakers, whatever month you're in, look at the history of, all y'all do is Google it. What happened in this month? What happened in the month of October as it pertains to Black history? And when you can get this information, and whenever you are speaking to an audience or youth or wherever, then you can mention what happened on these days or what days leading up to this event or days that will be coming shortly after this event or what happened on this day as it pertains to Black history. There's so many ugly lynchings that we don't know about, that we don't talk about, and massacres that have so much of an impact on where Black people are today. It wasn't just slavery. So much happened after slavery. People need to understand, so much happened after slavery. Even if we didn't even go back to slavery, you just pick up from what started happening around 1898, right there in Wilmington. The only coup d'etat that ever took place in the nation took place right there in Wilmington. Black folks were doing well. They had Black media. They had all these different Black businesses. What happened in Tulsa? All those Black blocks and blocks of Black businesses destroyed. We don't know how many national chains would have come out of those businesses. But we act like it didn't even happen. And then we added that we don't know why we are behind. We keep talking about, well, slavery was a long time ago. But So it didn't stop at slavery. And so, but the only way we'll know that, brother, my point is we have to come out of the box of this formal education where we think that we think it's sufficient. And we are allowing people to be paid based on what they receive out of formal education and not based on knowledge. If we were fair, a fair society, we wouldn't just talk about the education that can be controlled by the system. See, the school's education can be controlled. Even college education can be controlled. But what we would demand is that all knowledge have value, and therefore the person with that knowledge is valued. If it's a person who knows more, I might not know as much about this thing, but I might know more about that. And it might not have come with a particular degree, but the knowledge is there. And all you have to do is test me. All you have to do is ask me certain questions, and you'll find out that I have the knowledge regardless of where it came from, and you should pay me accordingly. But right now is people are making it very difficult for people who may not have a degree or a particular graduate degree, so on and so forth. Those things are good, and they should be appreciated, and there should be compensation for those things. But there should also be compensation for knowledge that did not come from a formal place, but people who took the initiative to learn and who are intelligent and who have a particular area of knowledge that would be helpful for an organization, such as the NAACP or whatever. Or it could be an organization such as some corporation. But it's knowledge. And that knowledge should be valued, and people should be compensated for it. But right now, we're just allowing people, the system, to control what education and define what education is. And that is why Carter G. Woodson comes to mind when he talks about the myth education that we often see as education. And therefore, that myth education, we're being rewarded of how much myth education we have. And oftentimes, the education and the knowledge that we actually have is devalued.
Ignore. No, that's very much the case and everything. One of the things before you got on the call and everything, I was telling Dean about some of the things that I had done, and I actually neglected to mention one of those, but I went to attend a couple of seminars, and they were online seminars and conferences, but two of them were African-based, and one of them was the Ghana Tech Summit, and the other was the Global Youth Summit or something like that, and I think it was based in Africa as well, and then there's the World Leader Summit, which is still going on, I think, until once they had started on the 7th or the 8th, it might be running until the 16th or the 19th or something like that. I forget the exact dates, but it's been going on, and I've heard a number of folks giving speeches about ways that we can make business decisions and do them on a global basis. And I do think that we need to find ways to connect with our African brothers on business and the other parts of the diaspora, whether that's the Caribbean or a number of other places. And we had a guest on sometime back, I think about a month ago, that talked about that. And I also feel that we need to do more encouragement of the development of our own businesses. You mentioned Tulsa, and of course, Durham had its Black Wall Street. And I sometimes hear people say that they don't think that a new Black Wall Street can ever be developed. So I was wondering if you could speak to your mind about economic empowerment and where we are with economic empowerment and what you would like to see having happen. Because I think that we need to actually find ways to connect with folks in, say, the different African nations, because Africa is a continent and it's got many nations within it, but also the brothers that are in the Caribbean, those brothers that are in the European countries and a number of other places around the world. And definitely I think we can create new kind of Black Wall Street kind of environments, be that here in Durham, be that in Raleigh, be that in Newark, New Jersey, be that in Tulsa. But I'd love to hear your thoughts.
First of all, my thought is, brother, the Black community establishing economic stability, education, I mean, economic businesses and economic foundation, Black-owned businesses, is no longer an option. It is necessary in order to survive as a race. It is a necessity. All other races know this. All other races, whether we're talking about immigrants from Mexico, Haiti or wherever an immigrant may come from, you will find even Black people who look like us but that might have come from Africa or Haiti or somewhere else, they understand the need for an economic base in the community, and they also have the confidence that I talked about earlier, that you need confidence in loving yourself and knowing yourself to make businesses happen. But if you have no confidence in yourself and you think that the only thing you can do is depend on a paycheck, then that's what you're going to do, and you're not going to aspire to do anything different. So number one, one of the first things, as I said earlier, one of the first organizations that I started was in Durham, Establishment for Economic Equality. And one of the things that we were trying to do there is to train our people in supporting Black-owned businesses. And if not supporting Black-owned businesses, then identify which businesses are necessary if we want to survive without our white counterparts. In other words, we as a community must identify, do an accounting of what we are missing if we were to become independent. And we need to fill those voids. In other words, if we have no place where we can buy groceries, then we need to identify that fact. We need to get with churches, business owners, or whomever, and say, you need a grocery store owned by Black folks. The person that's working now at the Walmart grocery store center or at the Food Lion, maybe that person who's maybe an executive over there or a general manager over there, maybe that person can help to be the manager of this store that we need to create for our community. But we need to do the same as we go down the list. Can we buy clothes? If we cannot buy clothes, things that we have to wear, then that is a void that we must fulfill. We must find someone who can help us to get a store that's owned by the Black community that sell clothes. We have to go down the list. You know, our children are going to need things, toys or whatever, a general store. We need someone that can do that. We're going to need transportation. We need someone who can do that. We need health. All these things that we must do to survive and provide life for ourselves and our families and the next generation, we should be somewhere identifying those businesses and coming together as a community to make it happen. When you study the history of the Black Wall Street and the people who worked together, those leaders who came together, one of which one of the main leaders was not really an educated man, but he knew the essentialness or how essential it was to own businesses. So he established the relationships. He didn't have to figure out everything for himself, but he knew it was going to take relationships with others to make it happen. And by the end of 1898, they were opening up National Life Insurance Company. At the same time, the people were fighting the battle over in Wilmington, taking Black folk and running them out of town for being prosperous. We had people over in Durham opening up North Carolina Mutual. If they could do it then, under such racist and hateful times, what makes us think we can't do it now? We're supposed to have people who are more educated now. We're supposed to be in a generation where it's supposed to be less racist now. Why can't we do it? And of course, we should do it if we're going to survive.
I definitely couldn't agree with you more on that and everything. That bell, by the way, was the 10-minute mark, and I definitely want to let you have a chance to talk about your show and everything. But before we get to that, I've also got to let Dean know, and then I know Dean may want to chime in with a thought or a comment about the words of wisdom that you've been sharing and everything. But a lot of folks don't know this about you, Minister Curtis Gatewood, as well. But not only are you a talented orator, a great leader in our community and all of that, but as I recall, you are also a fairly talented poet, and I want to say singer as well. So you definitely have those skill sets also. So definitely speak to those people that are in the entertainment field and in the music field as well as to the importance of that to what you do as well, because a lot of folks forget that aspect of you, but I do not, because I do know that you are a talented poet and I would argue a singer as well.
Lord have mercy. Maybe I'm a poet and don't know it, but I'm just kidding. Well, one thing, dear brother, I do want you to know
is that one of the things that bothers me is, in fact, how entertainment is being used. Well, at least it was being used to a greater extent probably during the 90s and late 80s than now, but it's still being used to our demise. And so what I would like to say to entertainers and those who are possibly considering entertainment is that we not be used by those who are out to destroy and tear down our communities. Because I talked about the need to rebuild the village. And one of the things that need to come out of the village is a unified message of inspiration and not degradation. And many of the messages that we're hearing, just if we can use our skills to make a message that is degrading, we can make one that's uplifting. If you're a poet and if you're an artist, if you can write, you can write what you want to write. And if you've been trained to write something that's degrading, then you need to look in the mirror and find out what it is that's causing that. And I know sometimes they would say, well, you know, you can make more money with this. But there are the scriptures which also say, for what is a man profited if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? You'll find that a lot of people made a lot of money. But what ended up happening is spiritual lack of development. They ended up resorting to drugs. They ended up resorting to self-degradation. They ended up basically being destroyed because they had no purpose. So what I would like to suggest is that we all find our purpose. Dr. King said, every man or woman or whatever gender identity you identify with, every person can be great. And one of the ways we can be great is because every person can serve. So I think a person's message and talent and gifts can serve a larger purpose. And I think that would do something not only for generations and young people who are in dire need of this, but it would also do something for the soul. Because we need soul power. Soul power meaning not necessarily fight against racism, but soul power, the right soul power, will automatically fight against racism because of what makes you right. And the key is being right, and whether that means fighting against racism or fighting against your own folk when they're wrong. But the key is being right. And so my poetry, what I try to do, is, you know, I usually try to deal more with the right side of history. So I have poems that deal with history. I recently did a poem that deal with my alma mater, Livingstone College. And because Livingstone College is a struggling HBCU, and they had a day when they wanted to kind of like do a big fundraiser. And I was hoping that my little rap, poetry that we ultimately put the music could help. So I write for different reasons, but usually my writing is like most things centered around the movement for justice. And I found out that I could write when I went to Livingstone College, because I didn't even realize I could write poetry until I went there and they showed me that, you know, hey, you know, you might have a little gift here, because we asked the class to do a poem and you did something that looked pretty interesting. You might want to consider, you know, doing more of that. And which, of course, I was inspired simultaneously by rap artists who were part of the pioneers, King Tim III from Fat Back Band, the Sugar Hill Gang, Curtis Blow, and so on. So that's where I'm coming from. And I just recommend, I think there's enough trash out here. I think some of us need to write more about what's right. And,
Definitely can agree with you more on that and everything. Definitely we need to have more people writing about right stuff and all of that. Before we have wrap the show up and everything, before we have Dean give you some thoughts of what you've been saying and everything, tell folks where they can catch you on Blog Talk Radio, because like I said at the beginning, you're joining our Blog Talk Radio family and are going to be doing a show with your brother. So definitely I would love to let folks know where they can hear this show and how often they can hear this show and the times and all of that. So if you'll share folks where they can catch you when they're not catching us on Monday nights and some of the other nights that we're on.
Amen. Well, y'all, the name of the blog show that I'm a part of is called, hold 1 minute, please.
Yeah. Dean, while we're waiting for him to come back, and hopefully he'll be back in a second and everything. Well, what are some of your thoughts about what Reverend Gatewood was sharing? Are you back, Reverend Gatewood?
Yeah, and I know you have to go. But I just wanted to say, just to make it short, if people can call, can tune into the radio station that, or with the radio blog that we're dealing with, called Brothers for Real. And what I just ask you to do is just Google Brothers for Real and see where you put in Brothers for Real. It's pertaining to the Gatewood family when we say Brothers for Real. But I'm not the host, but I'm just a part of the brothers. My brother, Leon Gatewood, is the host. Of course, Robert Gatewood is also, he has what is known as Marketing Pulpit, which is a big deal out there in the D.C. area that he does. And out of that came Brothers for Real. I have three brothers that are regularly a part of discussion, which comes on each Wednesday night at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Mark your calendars and do Brother for Real radio. I don't have information with me, sorry. But I'm sure if you all follow my page and if you follow Brother Mark Lee, I will make sure that he has the information where people can tune in. I'm praying that he can tune in. In fact, be one of our beloved guests, or just come in and just share his wisdom and his heart and his spirit whenever he can.
I would love to do that, and I'm sure that Dean would love to do that as well. Dean, what are some of your thoughts? You've heard Reverend Gatewood share a lot of knowledge and a lot of things going on, and I know we're wrapping up the show, but I'd love to hear your thoughts, and I'm sure that Reverend Gatewood would also love to hear the thoughts about what you've heard from Reverend Gatewood on this particular evening doing Straight Talk with Dean and Mark.
Well, it was a lot of information that was given out, and we appreciate Minister Gatewood for being with us. In short, we gotta do better, man. We gotta do better all the way around. Whether you are law enforcement, not law enforcement, whether you're highly educated or lower educated, we all gotta do our part, man, and to work towards a common goal. Get your feelings out the way. Get your biases out the way. You're gonna come up against things you don't like. You already know that. So take your feelings out of it as well, and work towards that goal in which you're trying to get things changed. You're trying to get things corrected that were wrong. And once we can get to that point right there, we could do something special, man.
Could agree with you more on that and everything. And one of the things I was going to say, one of the things I try to do on most of my shows, and I always succeed, because I don't think I did it on one of the afternoon streaming shows, is I always love to give folks a chance to give any words of encouragement, anything that they have not shared that they would like to share with the audience, just in terms of giving a positive, uplifting thought. So, Reverend Gatewood, if there's anything that you would like to share with our audience that you have not shared so far, just in terms of giving that uplifting message, I would love to hear that, and then Dean will come back and definitely tell what other shows we've got and what other places they can hear this show at. But definitely, if there's any words of encouragement that you would like to share, I'm sure our listeners would love to hear it.
Yes, I was born in a family of 16. We often ate saltines and pork and beans. Sometimes my sandwich had no meat, but God made a way for the family to eat. And even though the holes in my shoes would leak, at least I had shoes on my feet. I wore big clothes that my big brothers left me. We drank sugar water. We didn't have Pepsi. You see, my mama and my daddy knew Jesus. That's the only way that they could please us. You see, I've never been high on crack, but it's a fact that I jumped off track. But God brought me back. He made a new me. He's not through with me, but thank God I'm not what I used to be. That would be it.
Appreciate that. That was definitely a powerful way to go out and everything. And I think even Dean liked that one and everything. So, Dean, what are your thoughts about those poetic talents of Reverend Gatewood? And then you can also share a little bit about what we've got going on in this network of ours.
Well, we got about a minute before we get cut off. So that was a nice one right there, Reverend Gatewood. We appreciate that, y'all. It's Straight Talk with Dana Marr, Monday night, 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Don't forget to catch us our replay on the Skyhawk Radio Network tomorrow and Wednesday afternoons at 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. And if you missed those, we have replays on Radio Public, iHeartRadio, Google Podcasts, Spotify, Spreaker, TuneIn, Stitcher, Podbean, Apple Podcasts, Podchaser, Podcast Addict, CastBox, PodFollow, Deezer, Jay Savin, and right here on Blog Talk Radio, where we are a part of the Level Podcast Network, where you can also find the Black Girl's Guide to Surviving Menopause, the Chef Gang Radio Show, Funk from the Front Seat, Funk Music with Zach, Less K-12 Better, The Mark Lee Show, Marketing with Russ, Mona Shake, The Minority Report, Mulling Music and Memories with Mark Lee, The Online Dinner Party with Mark Lee, The Reinvention Road Trip, She's on Call, The Just Podcast, The Spin It Social Hour, Virginia Interfaith Live, and Western New York Original Music. Now, like I always say, when you walk outside your front door, showtime in the world is your stage. Just make sure that people are not watching the rehearsal. With that being said, it's the Sixth Man, Dean Geronimo, signing off. Have an outstanding week, and we see y'all in 7 days.
And in 7 days, we'll have two musicians joining us. That's right. It'll be a musical kind of conversation. We might have some other guests as well. But I know that we've got a return of Isabella Barks, but also another musician as well. So we know we'll have two musicians and who knows, maybe some political folks or some activists as well. But it'll always be some more great conversations. So please do join us again on the next Monday, the 21st. Because as Dean said, actually I think Dean might have done a miscount because he said that there was only three shows left, but I think he was counting this one. Because now that we're done with this one, there's only two shows left in the year of 2020, and that'll be the one on the 21st and the one on the 28th.
Yep.
So on that
we'll
note,
see y'all next week.